Welcome again. So this is the last session for today, and it's written that it's a VCQ special lecture. So normally VCQ invites distinguished professors to Vienna to share their research and experience with researchers in Vienna, and then today's lecture is included in this school because though the topic is not exactly the same, but it complements very well to the interest of this school. And then today we have Professor Roman Schnabel from Hamburg to deliver this lecture. And I will ask Jörg to introduce our today's speaker.
So, thanks. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Roman Schnabel. And I mean, we met a long time ago in various mm-hmm. types of conferences and things like this. So it just, you know, show you, I think it's a typical, you know, science career in Europe, or what he did. He did his PhD in Hannover and did something completely different, which was plasma physics and atomic spectroscopy. But after the PhD, I never found why did he switch to quantum optics.
Mm-hmm. Why? I found it more interesting.
Okay. Thanks. Yes. So he switched to quantum optics and went with a Theodor von Lünen stipend to the Australian National University, and there worked with Hans Bachor. And Hans was also here a few times giving seminars in our Friday seminar, so for the guys here in Vienna. And so there he basically, you know, learned quantum optics in mm-hmm. the, yep. from the real one of the pros of quantum optics mm-hmm. and squeezing and all these things.
Right.
Yeah. And then coming back from Australia, he got a junior professorship and then a professorship at the Leibniz University of Hannover, working on, you know, squeezing, building squeezers, basically. And then in 2014, he moved to a chair professorship in Hamburg and is there at the Center for Optical Technologies, or TOC. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so he basically, since 2002, he was involved in developing squeezed light sources for gravitational waves and gravitational detectors and other applications. And one of those is also quantum cryptography, but I think he will only talk about the applications into gravitational wave detectors. So he's basically, he owns the squeezing in LIGO, so to speak, or the, in the gravitational waves detectors. And for a long time, you had the world record in squeezing. Total world record in squeezing. I think still this world record mm-hmm. in squeezing for light.
Yeah.
And so, as he will tell you, it's not the limit of how good you can make a squeezed light. It's a limit how much you lose afterwards, what you can do with it. And he got many, many awards. He went in the Joseph F. Keithley Award for American Physical Society, an ERC Advanced Grant. He was a member of the team that got the Breakthrough Prize of Fundamental Physics in the LIGO, with the LIGO team, and a QCMC award for outstanding achievements in quantum experiments. And since 2003, he's a member of the GEO 600, and in 2005, member of the LIGO collaboration. And I think he will tell us, you know, why do you really need quantum physics to do gravitational wave detectors, or make them much better, make them much more sensitive? And so this is an real world application of quantum physics. Okay, Roman.
Yeah. Thank you, Jörg. Thank you for the kind introduction and also for the invitation here coming to Vienna. And yes, indeed. So my topic is squeezed light. As Jörg already told you, 20 years ago, I started as a postdoc in the group of Hans Albert Bachor at the Australian National University. And since 2003, I have been working first in Hanover, now in Hamburg. And my goal was to produce squeezed light, so to build a squeeze laser for gravitational wave detectors, and we succeeded basically in 2010. Okay, and yes, as you can see from the title, squeezed light now exploited by all gravitational wave observatories. The success in 2010 in GEO 600 in Germany was tremendous, and people at LIGO and Virgo decided that they also need a squeeze laser to get finally to the design sensitivity of these devices, because they experienced problems with increasing the light power, which is kind of the natural approach you would use to improve the sensitivity. But high light powers cause technical problems. So I will talk about the history of squeezed light. I will talk about gravitational wave detection. And here you see a Michaels interferometer as it is used for gravitational wave detectors in LIGO and in Virgo since 2019. So this is the actual, we say topology. And you have here a laser of about up to 200 watt of coherent light at 1064 nanometers, so 1 micron. On top, we have a squeeze laser here, and the squeeze laser is injected reverse, so in the direction, so into the output port of the gravitational wave detector. And the bright light here is reflected back towards the laser. Of course, the laser is protected. It wouldn't like to get all the light reflected into the resonator. And the squeezed uncertainty that is produced here is also reflected, goes over the arms, is reflected, and shows here a beat signal or a beat with the gravitational wave signal. And from the beat, you have the squeezed quantum noise. So the photon statistics is more shallow, so it's squeezed, it's reduced. So here you see, of course, we still have some noise, as you can see here, over time, some photoelectric voltage. And without squeezing, the noise would be higher here. So we are happy that the noise is reduced. And then you see the signal more clear. This is a signal of a merger of two black holes, the first signal we ever recorded in 2015 by LIGO. And at that time, LIGO did not use squeezed light. GEO-600 used squeezed light, already has been using already since 2010. But GEO-600 is not sensitive enough at the low frequencies we are talking about here, and could not see the signal. I will talk about the 2010 installation of a squeeze laser in GEO-600, which was built in my group by my PhD students. And I will talk about the success in also Virgo and LIGO. And I will talk about squeezed light, of course, all the time. I will try to explain to you how squeezed light is produced. I will show you many photographs and our vision that the Einstein telescope, the new European gravitational wave detector might get funding and will be commissioned in 2034, 35 maybe. Of course, again, with squeezed light. Just as a side remark, when you inject squeezing into this port here, the squeezing splits and you have then entangled optical fields in the arms, quantum entanglement. So we're really using entanglement to improve the sensitivity. And squeezing is strongly related to entanglement. Okay, history. So when you look up publications, you find this work by Stoller from 1970, and you find in this work the definition of the squeeze operator. You have creation operators twice, so you produce photon pairs when you produce a squeezed vacuum state. I will come to this. You also find the squeeze parameter here, which gives you the strength, how good, how strong the squeezing is. And when you then go here to the work by Lu, just 1 year later, and this was independent work as far as I know, you see, for example, this equation, this superposition, you see that the squeezed vacuum state, zero here means zero displacement in phase space, so squeeze vacuum. R is the squeeze parameter, theta is the squeeze angle, and you see it is a superposition of photon pairs, 0, 2, 4, 6, and so on. And this is well known. And if you then go here to UN, you find the squeeze ellipse. So instead of looking at the photon pairs you could observe by counting photons with click detectors. This phase space is based on measurements where you measure the electric field. And this X is the electric field strength at the antinode of the harmonic wave. And Y is a non-commuting observable, is the electric field at the node. Yeah. And at the node, there is not precisely zero electric field. There is some uncertainty. And here you see, yeah, a squeezed vacuum state because the center is at the origin, and you see the uncertainty in the amplitude noise is reduced, and the squeezing or the end and the uncertainty at the node is increased. So here we see an, so to speak, yeah, a squeezed vacuum in relation to some local oscillator giving you amplitude squeezing. This is also the Wigner function, so a quasi probability distribution of electric field quadratures. And then, of course, Carlton Caves, who in 1981 thought, okay, this squeezing could help to improve gravitational wave detectors. He thought, okay, we will never be able to produce lasers that provide sufficiently high powers, powers that we need up to a megawatt light in an arm. But since then, we know we can do a lot with recycling cavities, Fabry-Pérot cavities, built-up cavities in the arm, so we don't need a laser giving 1 megawatt. And in the end, laser physics improved a lot, so it's now possible to build a 200-watt single-frequency, really stable laser, and this laser that is in operation at LIGO was built in Hannover at the laser center and also at the Institute for gravitation wave physics and the Max Planck Institute, the Albert Einstein Institute. So today the problem is slightly reversed. We can produce the high powers, but the power is that high that the mirrors are disturbed. So we're looking for alternatives, and keeping the power where it is at the maximum level plus squeezing improves the sensitivity of a gravitational wave detector. Increasing the heat load to the mirrors. So what you find in Cave's publication here is electric field of a monochromatic wave over time. And here you see a lot of uncertainty in the antinode and here. And here you see very small uncertainty in the node. So this is a phase squeezed state. Or if you, you can also use this the phase space probability distribution S here. So this ellipse here is basically a cut through this three-dimensional object. Coming to gravitational waves. So what are gravitational waves? You have, let's say, a binary system, billion of light years away, and two black holes, for example, rotate around each other. And in the far field, you see that the universe is stretched and also squeezed. So it shrinks in one direction, in transversal direction, and it is expanded in the other one. And this is propagating as a wave with the speed of light. It's a transverse wave. It's a quadrupole wave. And if you now want to measure changes of this space-time, then a Michaels interferometer is the perfect device for it. So to make this more clear, you put, for example, a spacecraft here, free-floating, no forces, another one here. They stay at their coordinate system, but when a gravitational wave passes, the distances still change, although they are locally not accelerated at all, because space-time itself is stretched. Yeah? The light sees this because the light travels along an expanding universe, at least if the phase of the gravitational wave is like this, or in a shrinking universe when the phase of the gravitational wave is like this. So what does light do when it travels through expanding space-time? You all know this, it gets a redshift. Because we know this, because the universe is expanding and all the light we can measure here is as sometimes very, very strong redshift. For example, the microwave background now is really microwaves, but it used to be at really high frequencies. Right, so we have, for example, we have here red-shifted light and here blue-shifted light. The reflected light has some phase difference. This phase difference produces some interference, and the output power here changes. So what we measure is the change of light power. And this change is a full picture of the gravitational wave amplitude. And the gravitational wave amplitude is given as this delta L times 2 divided by L. This is H, the gravitational wave amplitude. And for example, if you have a system that is far away from merging, you have basically a monochromatic wave. So the output light power here would not be stable around 10 milliwatt, for example, but would show this power change. And that is a signal. Okay, here a photograph of one of the two LIGO detectors. They have arm length of 4 kilometers. They are in the US, one in Livingston, this one here, and the other one across the continent, 3,000 kilometers away in Washington. And this one here is located in a forest, and there was some noise, and because the people dragged wood over through this area here, but the LIGO people managed to build this gravitational wave detector composed of free floating mirrors and a very, very noiseless laser beam. And they measured the gravitational waves in 2015. And you probably have seen the first signal ever. So you probably know these graphs here. On this axis here, we have H again, the gravitational wave amplitude. And here we have time, and time goes over a fraction of a second, from 0.3 to 0.45 seconds. So it's a very short event. And the light power in the Hanford detector, here's some noise, but here you clearly see some oscillation and a chirp. The frequency went up. At the same time, just shifted by 7 milliseconds, the detector in the south in Livingston measured almost the same signal. And here you see that they are really identical. So the red one is the Hanford signal, the blue one is the Livingston signal. In the second row here, you see the theoretical models derived from general relativity, adjusting the parameters of two black holes, so the masses of and the distance of this binary system, in such a way that it basically matches the signal. And the result was really convincing, right? So you see here the theory where you vary the parameters a bit. But in the end, if you subtract from this observation, this fitting result, let's say, you see here a rather white residual noise, which is, of course, a clear sign that this was is a good description. And 7 milliseconds difference, that means, okay, the gravitational wave obviously came from the south, hit the Livingston detector first, and then the Hanford detector. 7 milliseconds was a strong sign that everything was most likely gravitational wave detector, because the direct distance is 10 milliseconds. So the gravitational wave came not like this, but slightly under an angle. Yeah. And this here, we could see on the screen directly in real time. There was no further data processing necessary. So the people were watching their monitor said, wow, this is exactly what we have talked about all the years. There's a question. Right, so the signals are not exactly the same. That was the correct observation. And this is because the two observatories are under an angle, so the sensitivity for this particular gravitational wave was not the same. And and that creates this difference. Yeah. All right. So here's the result from this quick analysis we did. So we had two black holes. One was 36 solar masses. The other one was 29 solar masses. They merged into the final black hole, which was then created at times after this year, a sphere producing no gravitational wave. So the signal stopped. And this black hole had a mass of 62 solar masses, according to general relativity. Three solar masses are gone because this energy was radiated away by the gravitational wave. And the distance here of 1.3 billion light years could be deduced from the absolute calibration we have in the observatories. So we know how strong the signal is, and of course, some tiny redshift. So this all is, of course, included here. What is also included here is a filter. The gravitational wave detectors only had high sensitivities above 35 hertz. So at lower frequencies, the signal was not observable. And what did we do? We placed an electronic filter that passed only frequencies above 35 hertz and below 350 hertz. But this is the reason why you don't see anything here. Of course, the gravitational wave was already here at previous times, for millions of years, but the frequency was too small for detectors on ground. I very much like this graph. You find it in the same manuscript, in the same publication. It is the same signal, but now as a time frequency analysis. And what you see here is how the frequency changed over time, and the strength, so the amplitude, is here color coded. And what you see here is this X. So the optical field in the output port, the amplitude of the optical field, it is the X quadrature, which is important when you go to quantum optics. It is one of these non-commuting observables, but frequency resolved over some band and versus some time. And this is proportional to the gravitational wave amplitude. Why do I find this so interesting? Because here you see the Fourier limit when you do data analysis. So you see here, the signal seems to be quite fuzzy, and you might ask, okay, why is there not really a line here? The frequencies grow, okay, fine, but why is it so fuzzy and so broad? Yeah, the reason is Fourier transformation. If you have a signal that changes in time its frequency, the frequency cannot be precise at some time, right? So if you look here, you have let's say here frequencies of 130 hertz plus minus 25. This is this bar here. And then you get an area, and the time span is 0.003, so 3 milliseconds in that case, around this timing of 0.42 seconds. And if you then compare these two numbers here, so the widths, you see this is at the Fourier limit. So it's not possible to make here some line, right? And this also is related to our quantum optics. This is what we always do. We ask, okay, what is the mode we are talking about? What is the mode that is in a squeezed state? And then we say, okay, it is a sideband field of our optical monochromatic laser. And we look at modulations of 130 hertz in a band of plus minus 25. And this is a mode in frequency. There is a correspondence in time due to the Fourier transformation. And this is the mode, this is the physical system. And this can be in a coherent state, or in a squeezed state, or an entangled state. Here it was in a coherent state. But the more recent observations from LIGO, the noise is from the optical point of view is in a squeeze state, at least if you go to some higher frequencies where we actually can observe, make use of the squeezing. Okay, I would like to explain squeezed light. First of all, in a gravitational wave detector, we have almost monochromatic light. Why? Because this is the most predictable light you can have. We have some light level, and you would like to see tiny fluctuations on it. So the light should be as stable as possible. The only thing you can do is a monochromatic light wave with the coherence times of seconds. And here again, I show you what the two quadratures are. The X is electric field in the antinode, Y in the node, 90 degrees out of phase. And they have a commutator that is not zero. So there is a Heisenberg uncertainty relation which tells you you cannot measure X and Y both precisely at the same time. You can measure X more precisely, and you can even produce a state of some of light where the uncertainty in X is smaller, but then the uncertainty at Y must be bigger to still obey the Heisenberg uncertainty relation. And that is here as an amplitude squeeze state, because in the amplitude, the uncertainty is squeezed. Okay, that needs now to be related to our measurement with a photodiode in the output port of the gravitational wave detector, where we only measure power, so to speak, photon numbers per time interval. And this is illustrated here. We have a time axis, and we measure, let's say, to give you a number, for 1 millisecond, we collect all the photons. And this gives you one value of the photoelectric voltage. Why 1 millisecond? Yeah, because this is short enough to see a fast oscillating signal on our light with a coherence length of a second. So we have long coherence times, but short measurements. Well, this is a must. There's no way to do it indifferently. But then we see from the collected photons, we have fluctuations. And this is here just the photon counting statistics for large photon numbers. It's a Gaussian profile, and it is this plus minus square root of average photon number, which you know for a coherent state. And when you now have such a state, so the noise here doesn't matter, because what you see is the photon numbers, which is A dega A or alpha star alpha. So you need to look at the strongest amplitude of the field, and this brings you the photons. So it's important to squeeze it here. And this squeezing now makes the photon counting measurement more precise, and you see better the signal. And for 10 dB of squeezing, for example, you have here this 10. This is a huge amount, a significant effect, say. So my PhD students, first of all, Henning Fahlbruch, in his PhD designed, so we did 10 years of fundamental research and development, but in the end, in 2008, Henning submitted his PhD thesis, and he prepared everything to build the first squeezer, the first squeeze laser for a gravitational wave detector. And in 2010, the situation was the following. We had the squeezer built, and we had GEO-600, the gravitational wave detector, south of Hannover, and here you see the noise of this observatory. The noise is basically arm length strain or differential arm length strain. So the noise that one arm gets shorter and the other longer. Of course, there's always noise, of course, and the noise was on a level of space-time strain 10 to the minus 21, which is almost at the level where you could expect statistically to measure some gravitational waves, but not quite there. So there was a little bit missing. And then you have all these features, all these noise features. So here, these are the violin modes of the suspended mirrors. I have not talked about the mirrors. So you need free floating objects in space. And we use mirrors, big mirrors, suspended on fibers. And the fibers have violin vibrations like a guitar. And they are around 600 hertz, and this is all this stuff here. Some features we do not know where they come from, but we suspected that this line here is given by, so this ground level of noise is given by photon counting noise. And then we brought in the squeeze laser. And indeed, here the noise dropped by 3.5 dB, which is a factor of two, a little bit more of two. And that, of course, improved now when you have it calibrated to space-time strain, the performance of the observable observatory. Here, the noise was not limited by photon counting noise, but by seismic noise, electronic noise, and so on. So we couldn't do anything against that one. But this here was a really great success. It was the first application of some non-local light, like entanglement, in an application. And it was useful because the other possibility to just increase the light power by a factor of 2 point something, corresponding to this dB, would have done the same job with this normalization. But this was not possible because the beam splitter showed already some deformation and the interferometer was not stable anymore, this high powers. Okay, we had a look at the numbers. Yes, we injected the squeeze laser, was really good. We produced 10 dB of squeezing. We only saw 3.5 dB, but this is exactly what you expect. When you send in some light and you lose 38% of your photons, then 10 dB improvement reduces to 3.5% improvement. To make it even more clear that this is a really kind of historical result, historical experiment, you could ask the question, all right, how good is it really what we did here? Can you do better with this observatory at the same level of light power and the same optical loss with some other states? Why squeeze states? What about noon states? Maybe noon states are even better. So we investigated this together with Rafael Demkovic-Dobransky and Konrad Banacek in Warszawa. And this is a theoretical paper. And we found out, well, the answer to this question is a no. Even perfect noon states would not improve this significantly. And to give you some example, this is the ultimate limit the detector could have reached with this light power and with this optical loss of 38%. And we were extremely close. And the next step, what we should have done is to produce slightly higher squeezing, not 10 dB injected, but 16 dB. And then you could not see any difference between the red line and the noise left in the interferometer. Noon states are not necessary and they would not work because a noon state is a macroscopic, non-classical, like a cat state, a Schrödinger cat state, and these photon numbers n here needs to be 10 to the 20. So no way. N equal 5 has been demonstrated. So squeezing is produced by parametric down conversion. Yeah, there's a question. Yes, so the role of the squeezed light in the apparatus. The role is to reduce the noise on the photodiode. This is the role because the noise that is given by the photon statistics on the photodiode is a problem at high frequencies, so above a kilohertz. I will come to this, and if there are still questions left, you can maybe ask it again after the talk. I would like to now tell you a little bit more about history. There's another question, okay? This is a very difficult question. This question targets also the mechanical oscillator, which is a pendulum. As I said, the mirrors are suspended as pendula. And of course, if you have a mass, every mass, even if the 40 kilogram mass, like the mirrors in LIGO, has some uncertainty in position and also momentum. There's also Heisenberg uncertainty relation. And this question is about the correlation between the light uncertainty and the mechanical oscillator. This is a little bit too advanced. I cannot cover this in this talk, but it is a good opportunity for me to tell you that here we only do quantum noise squeezing of the light, because there is nothing that we engineer with the uncertainty of the mirror. First of all, the reason is that the quantum noise of the mechanical oscillator would appear basically at 1 hertz, because we have a 1 hertz pendulum. And at these frequencies here, and at every frequency where we can measure gravitational waves on ground, which is above 10 hertz, this uncertainty is not important. But the radiation pressure of the light can produce a coupling between the mechanical oscillator uncertainty and the light uncertainty, and produce entanglement between optomechanical system. But this is a topic I will not cover today. So I'm concentrating on the squeezed light, and the first experiment about parametric down conversion is this one, to the best of my knowledge, in 1970, observation of simultaneity in parametric production of optical photon pairs. It is called also spontaneous parametric down conversion. And then, of course, there are other light sources, like the ones that have been used for violating Bell inequalities by Alain Aspect. They used atoms to produce photon pairs. And also Slusher, who was the first who produced, in fact, squeezed light, which is not just spontaneous parametric down conversion, it is also induced parametric down conversion. Now, that's a difference. You have more than just pairs. And but he used also four wave mixing in atoms. And what is very close to what we do now in gravitational wave detectors is the first experiment by Jeff Kimball and others in 1968. And here he used a crystal, a laser crystal, a nonlinear crystal that is pumped by second harmonic light, and he generated squeeze states. And here you see the squeeze factor was already 3 dB, so a reduction of the quantum noise by factor of 2 invariance. Here it was only a few percent. So this is here really something that is closely related to what we are now doing. And this type of technology has been used also by the group of Jürgen Lünneck in Konstanz in the 90s. And here's also a very nice paper published in Nature about measurement of the quantum states of squeezed light. Yeah, and then also teleportation experiment. This, in fact, was one of the experiments that motivated me to change from plasma spectroscopy to quantum optics, because 1998 was about the time when I was close to finish my PhD in Hannover. And I thought, okay, this is something I really do not understand at all. This I want to do. I want to do a teleportation experiment. And then we did the teleportation experiment in Australia in Hans Bacher's group, 5 years later than this one here. Right, so here I refer to three experiments, famous experiments. We have about 3 dB of squeezing, and the squeezing is related to the uncertainty in a sideband of 5 megahertz. That means you have an optical field, and if you do a frequency analysis of the quantum uncertainty, you can say, okay, some of the uncertainty is at low frequencies, some of the uncertainty is related to megahertz. What we only could do is squeezing at megahertz. But if we would like to measure gravitational waves between 10 hertz and 10 kilohertz, we need quantum noise squeezing exactly in this frequency regime. And we need much more of a squeezing factor. So this was, in fact, the situation when I came to Australia. There were already very, very good experiments. And they had also squeeze lasers built, homemade, home-built. And also good detectors. And here you see a typical measurement from the early 2000s. Megahertz frequencies, noise power of the light, which is a measure of the photon counting statistics. The detector shows here white noise So above 2 megahertz, this is, we verified this. This was photon shot noise. Detector dark noise was lower, which was good. And what we wanted to do in the end, we wanted to have squeezing down here, yeah, there. 10 hertz to 10 kilohertz, larger squeeze factors, large squeeze factors, and also some control over the state we wanted to produce. So when we measured squeezing, we saw squeezing in megahertz frequencies as the other people before. Here, just 2 dB. But at lower frequencies, we saw a lot of noise, obviously technical noise. And this one here was clearly the laser relaxation oscillation of our Mephisto neodymium laser. And so we coupled in our squeezing measurement also noise from the laser. And it was very difficult not to do this because we used some light for controlling the experiment. And so the question was, how can we get rid of this light, really producing a squeeze vacuum without any displacement, but then we lose a full control over everything. And how can we stabilize the squeeze ellipse that is not rotating, right? So that was very big problems. And in the end, yeah, when I came back to Germany, in the end, we together with Australian colleagues, we solved all these problems here and we got to the these measures here. I will come to this, but here how it looks like. So a squeeze laser is basically a laser. You have a laser crystal. This is, for example, KTP, periodically polled. You have a cavity around it, so a laser cavity. Here's one mirror, the outcoupling and incoupling mirror, and here the back surface is polished and highly reflective. And then you pump such a cavity with green light at 532 nanometers, if you would like to have squeezing at 1064 nanometers. And so you shine in the, you focus in the light into, you match the input, the pump light to the cavity mode, and you do nothing more, only have, keep the resonator length stable. And what comes out are then, photon pairs, higher order photon pairs. What comes out is a mode in a squeezed vacuum state. And everything, of course, we build very, very stable. You see it here, the housing is quasi monolithically screwed and temperature stabilized to get the phase matching condition and so on and so on. Here you see a sketch of the experiment. So you buy a commercial laser, a continuous wave, for protecting you. Here you need an isolator to protecting the laser, and then you first do second harmonic generation to get the green pump. You filter this spatially, and then you inject it into this squeeze resonator. And the output here is a squeezed field. You overlap, because we do not count photons here. We use a bright beam as a bright beam that comes out of a gravitation wave detector, 10 milliwatts. We overlap it on a 50-50 beam splitter, and we use two photodiodes, and we look at the difference photo voltage, and this is a balanced homodyne detector. The good thing is, if you do it like this, that all the noise that comes with this beam is canceled out when you do the subtraction. And what remains is the noise that enters here, because a beam splitter always has a phase flip on one side due to the reflection. So when you subtract the noise from the bright beam, you add up the statistics or the signal from this beam here. And so what was the trick to now to go from 3 dB to maybe 10 dB? So what we did in this time, you see it here, 2001, this 2010, we got photodiodes with greater than 99% quantum efficiency. So 99% of the photons that are that arrive on the photodiode are actually transformed into exactly one photoelectron with 99% efficiency. What else? We improved our contrast here. You need a very high interference contrast. If you don't have that, you lose light again, because the only signal you really measure is the beat signal between these two inputs. Then, we improved a lot the length stability control of these resonators. And in the end, we were able, so in 2006, we were able to produce squeezed light here, about 6 dB, over the full frequency range of gravitational wave detectors, even lower. So we start here with 1 hertz. But from 10 hertz to 10 kilohertz is the spectrum we are aiming for. And you see that the noise dropped by about 6 dB over the full spectrum. And when this was published, the first people at LIGO and Virgo thought, okay, maybe we can really do it. But there was a lot of work to do in terms of convincing the people still in 2006. We also worked on the squeezing strength, but here it is again at megahertz frequencies, but eventually we reduced the optical loss down to just 5% in total, 99% quantum efficiency of detectors, plus another 4 from losses somewhere in the experiment. And we got 10 dB of noise reduction here. And this was basically a benchmark, a factor of 10. That means a factor of 10 in light power in a gravitational wave detector. A factor of 10 is huge, right? So, and this was maybe then really the start that people thought, okay, we are going to do this. And the people from GEO, I could convince in 2007, I remember the evening where we made the decision that we will implement it in GEO 600 first. Okay, what happens in this nonlinear crystal? How is squeezed light produced? We have to look at the dielectric polarization of the medium, so of the crystal. And here I show you in red are some charge distributions, so atoms, electrons, and they are locally, because an insulator, locally it's neutral. And if you now shine in the light in this direction here, and there's no light, so basically a node, no electric field, the charges are not separated. But when you then have an electric field vector from the light, then the electrons, which are lighter, are moved a bit, not very far, just a bit. And this polarizes the medium. And then it goes further, obviously. Yeah? And the light that is emitted from the crystal is just what you see from the emission of this oscillation here, the dipole oscillation. So what this is just the conventional, from this you can construct the refractive index of a medium. Yeah? In the linear case, the frequency is not changed. But now the difference is the acceleration of, or the oscillation of these charges here are not linear. So they are not harmonic, even if the light is an harmonic oscillation. And that gives you then the anharmonics and the entrance for nonlinear optics. So here you see the linear term. So the polarization of the medium follows exactly the electric field. But there's a quadratic component and the cubic component and so on. And these components, here you see the Taylor expansion, are linked to nonlinear optical effects. So we need a medium with a large chi2 factor to produce second harmonic light or to do parametric down conversion for squeezed light. If you have a medium with a large chi3, you can do third harmonic generation or four wave mixing, or you can see the optical Kerr effect, so intensity dependent phase shift. Right, so we were concentrating, of course, on this one here. Yeah, this is the linear term and the important nonlinear one. And now I will give you a graphical, nice picture to see how squeezing develops. And the start is exactly this graph here. We have the electric field of the input light. We have the polarization of the medium, which is producing the emitted light, including higher orders. And if you only look at these two components, then you have not just a straight line, but some contribution from a parabola. And this is what I show here. Okay, so how does it work in this graph? We take pump light, green pump light, which is very strong, and we take some uncertainty, so some zero point fluctuation of some mode that fits into our resonator. And now I simply, yeah, and this dashed line here is just to remind you that this ground state uncertainty, although it looks simply like a phase-independent quantum noise here, belongs to a certain mode having a certain optical frequency. And the only reason why I have here the dashed white line is to remind you that there is some optical frequency behind it. I'm talking about a certain frequency. But the uncertainty is, yeah, phase-independent. Okay, and this I now propagate here in a graphical way. And you see now the following. When the pump light has a very positive, high positive electric field, it drives the blue uncertainty into this regime where the material has a high slope. And the respondent is an increase of the uncertainty. When you go here, where the electric field is strongly negative, you drive the uncertainty in this regime where the material is not that strongly responding to the input electric field. And here you see what happens to the output uncertainties that go now to the right. It transfers this noisy harmonic wave into some noisy non-harmonic wave just because of this construction here. And then you need to decompose it into different frequencies. So you find again the pump frequency, you find, which is the green one here, you find even second harmonic generation of the pump, which is something we don't want. And you see an uncertainty that is here squeezed, exactly where the minima are, and anti-squeezed at the maxima. And I told you already, you cannot have both. If you squeeze the uncertainty at one phase, let's call it X, you need to anti-squeeze at the other, call it Y. And this is exactly what we have here. So the blue uncertainty is a squeezed vacuum, which is produced in the crystal. And this is basically the parametric down conversion you see here, or also called optical parametric amplification. And this field here now is composed of 2 photons, 4 photons, 6 photons, and so on. And this field we need to inject into a gravitational wave detector. Right, the uncertainty is squeezed at some phases. And if you want to know more about this, because there are still some pictures required to understand how the resonator works, the resonator that has such a medium inside, then I would like to refer you to the review article I wrote a couple of years ago. What about squeezed vacuum and bright squeezing? Well, that's a simple thing, but I also would like to mention, if you have amplitude squeeze state here, you see again the harmonic wave and the uncertainty distribution. Of course, this is just a superposition because we're talking about electric fields. You can superimpose this in two things, in the expectation value, which is the classical red oscillation, and you consider the noise separately. So an amplitude squeeze state is nothing else as a perfect classical carrier superimposed with a squeeze vacuum state. And so the picture I gave you just before can also be adapted to show how this is produced directly. I have shown you how the squeezed vacuum is produced, but the message here is there's no difference. We can superimpose a classical field afterwards and get amplitude squeezing, phase squeezing, whatever we want when we start from a squeezed vacuum state. Also, these pictures should be mentioned. So here you have a phase space and this object is rotating and the projection here gives you exactly this oscillation. So here you have a squeeze ellipse at the end of a displacement arrow. And you can also consider them differently, the displacement arrow rotating and the squeeze vacuum ellipse rotating around the origin. So again, you see here the possibility of superposition, right? You can separate them. That's what you always do in quantum physics. You can separate the expectation value from the noise operator. And this is what we also do in this picture. Now I would like to come to the photon numbers. You can measure photon clicks on a squeeze state. And I would like to give you the relation to it. So here again, we measure not photons. Here we measure electric field. A balanced homodyne detector measures electric field strength and no photon clicks. And here you see this squeezed vacuum state. This is what I said already, the non-zero commutator. And this is not really strong squeezing. This corresponds to a squeeze parameter of R equal 0.5. And if you look at the variances, you calculate e to the power of 2r and the variance. So the quantum noise, the variance of the quantum noise uncertainty is here increased by square root 2.7 and here squeezed by square root of 2.7. So the difference between here and here is square root times square root. So this is a factor of 2.7. Or what we use more frequently is we use a dB scaling. And here you see how we come from the squeeze parameter to dBs. Okay, electric field strength. But now we can also, we could also count photons. And what you will find is that in for such a squeezed vacuum state, we would see almost 90% of the measurement events. We measure zero photons in the state. Theoretically, and we measure about 10% two photons. There are also four photons, six, eight, and so on. So we have only even numbers of photons. That refers to the original work, 1971, I have shown you, the photon numbers. And I would like to point out here the following. Spontaneous parametric down conversion is the occurrence of just pairs, because you shine in light and the light can be thought of composed of photons, the green photons, and every photon splits into two photons at 1064 nanometers. And this is spontaneous. And this has been used for many, many Bell test experiments. But if you go further, if you have put a cavity around and you recycle the photon pairs, they can also produce induced emission of pairs. And then you get, four or six photons. So, and this induced emission is important because it allows me to talk about a squeeze laser. It is not a parametric down converter anymore. It's a laser because we have light amplification by induced emission. It's a very low level of induced emission. It's far above, it's below threshold, but you can operate such a device below threshold, then it's called an OPO. You can operate it far above threshold, that's all possible. But it's already a laser. And also the characteristics of the spatial mode is already like a laser. We have transversely a perfect TEM00 mode that can be matched perfectly into the gravitational wave interferometer without any loss. It's not like in parametric down, in spontaneous parametric down conversion experiments where the photons are all over the place. Yeah? It's completely different. Okay, so here is the squeeze laser, the first ever. First ever in terms of turnkey suitable for gravitational wave detectors. There were many, many proof of principle experiments before. Which one? This one was built by my PhD student, Henning Fahlbruch, and also by another PhD student, Sascha Kalajdowski. And it was really big, 1.5 square meter, but it worked. And it had 9 dB of squeezing over the full band from 10 hertz to 10 kilohertz. So we brought that one from Hannover to GEO 600, 20 kilometer ride, and we brought it into the clean room. Here you now you see the central building of a gravitational wave detector, many vacuum chambers where you hang the mirrors. And you also see here, maybe this tube here, this goes 600 meter along this way. There's a mirror and reflects it back. In this chamber, you have the beam splitter, which overlaps the other beam that goes into this direction. And here you have the output port and the photodiode. And we wanted to place this squeeze laser in the output port of GEO 600. And we were extremely happy when we opened everything. It looked very good. And we started the squeeze laser one day after, and it still was working. And then it took us 10 months to inject the light carefully into GEO 600 to get this result I have already shown. Because the mode matching, of course, is quite critical. Motivation for squeezed light. As I told you, you have the strongest light here in the 4 kilometer long arm cavities. But here you have absorption and the surface deforms. And this does not allow LIGO and Virgo to further increase the power. On top, there is something like parametric instabilities. These 40 kilogram suspended mirrors start ringing up internal vibrations like the butterfly mode, because the light puts energy into the internal mode of the mirrors. But squeezing is here, the way to go, because when you do not increase the light power here, but you simply reduce the photon shot noise, you can reach a design sensitivity that was promised to the agencies. And here is now two publications from 2019. So although neither LIGO nor Virgo were designed to use squeezed light, but they had a sensitivity target, they decided around 2000, maybe 14, 15, to reach the sensitivity target, not by scaling up the light power, but spontaneously by using squeezed light. So this was a success of our experiment in Hannover. And here you see the improvement in LIGO. You see these 2.7 dB, in Virgo almost 3 dB. And in these two publications, there are also two sentences, statements. Of course, the squeezing is only helpful at higher frequencies, above 100 hertz, and here a little bit below 100 hertz, but this statement is still correct. The neutron star merger rate in Virgo is improving by this improvement by plus 25%, and the overall event rate in LIGO even by plus 50%. Just because of squeezing, of course, people do all other improvements at the same time. Or just to pinpoint on this detection here, it was 2019, April 12th, we observed a merger of a 30 solar mass black hole plus 8 solar masses. Here you see again the ring up, the chirp, and at frequencies, let's look here, at frequencies above 100 hertz, the noise is now reduced, as you can see here. So in this part of the detection, we now had a clearer signal just due to the squeezing. All right. So now something completely different, still related to squeezed light. Maybe you know that some people were always arguing squeezing that is close to the heart of quantum physics. It is kind of weird. And then other people said, why? What is weird on squeezed light? You have a positive Wigner function. You only have a little bit reduced of noise. So where, in fact, is the weirdness? And here I published this in Annalen der Physik last year. Here, I think I can now really focus to make clear where the weirdness, in fact, is, although the Wigner function is positive. Okay, let's start. We have extremely monochromatic light here with coherence times of a second. If we now, and this is because we don't want to have any noise at 100 hertz. And if we now collect the photons over milliseconds, we get this photon counting noise. And this photon counting noise is a Poissonian distribution. And there must be some noise because every portion of energy in this beam, any photon, if you like, must be smeared out over the coherence length of a kilometer, over the coherence length of a second, because it's so monochromatic. Yeah, the light is so monochromatic that you can use the Fourier transformation, and from the width in spectrum, you get a width in time, and the width in time is more than a second. Fourier transformation. But now we do something rude. We subtract energy within a millisecond, although every photon has an uncertainty over a second. So what does it mean? There is some coupling between the photodiode here and this highly monochromatic light. But this coupling is only small. So some energy portions will be detected. And this must be completely random. There's no other way, because every photon was distributed over a second, right? There are no hidden variables. That's exactly it. If this light is monochromatic, there is no information, no hidden variable where a photon could be localized. Every photon needs to be smeared out over a second. But now we measure it in a millisecond. This, and the result can only be a random, a truly random photon counting statistics. And this is why we have here the Poissonian or the square root n fluctuation. And here you see, this is a side remark, here you see why this is bad when you want to observe an oscillation from a gravitational wave signal. Now, we squeeze it, but we squeeze exactly the same light. We squeeze a light where the photons are uncertain over a second without any hidden variables, which is forced and forced by Fourier transformation. And now we get photon numbers. How is it possible that these photon numbers show quantum correlations? So if we measure this first, then all others are very close. How is that possible? We have the photons are delocalized over a second. We subtract within milliseconds, we get photon numbers, and they should be random because there are no hidden variables, but they are not really, they are random, but they are correlated. Yeah. So if the first one is randomly here, then the other ones are very close. And this is weird. This is quantum weirdness. I'm happy to answer questions regarding this because maybe it is a little bit difficult to follow what I'm showing here. But here you see again how nice it is if you then measure a gravitational wave with squeezed noise. Entanglement, yeah. This is not in the focus of my talk, but I would like to mention it. What is entanglement? You always need two systems, A and B, two light beams, and you need two non-commuting observables here, X and Y. And X and Y has some ground state uncertainty. Here it's displaced ground state uncertainty, but this is the uncertainty you can only do with one when the other one is increased. Right. And there's a Heisenberg uncertainty relation. Okay, so systems A and B are entangled if you have covariances. So you look at sums and differences of the electric fields and the electric fields at the nodes. And if that is smaller than one, then there's a criterion for Gaussian states by Duan, Gigge, Zirac, Zoller, and also by Simon from 2000. Why? Yeah, because if you look here, every variance has 1/4 × 1/4. It's the lowest is 1/16. And if you have no correlations, you have 1/4, 1/4, and so on, it sums up to 1. This is what you get for a coherent state. But for squeezing here, what do we get here? Yeah, we have squeezing that is, we have some squeezing in the, let's say, amplitude quadrature, and this is smaller than 1/4. It's squeezed, maybe 1/40 for 10 dB squeezing. And that means this inequality goes to, we have here in the difference, right. So this is not a mistake that I swapped from X now the squeezing to Y. I did that because the interferometer exchanges phase signals into amplitude signals. So this is correct, but yeah. Okay, so we have here in the difference, if you have some classical measurement and you subtract basically the same one, you end up with a vacuum noise. But here, when we sum up the result from here and there, it is like undoing the splitting. We see the squeezing, and this is certainly smaller than one. So we fulfill an entanglement criterion that is sufficient and necessary for Gaussian states. So GEO600 in the meantime can produce 6 dB of squeezing. So it would improve from 3.5 to 6. And it is a real application. And you see this when you look up this paper here. So the Hannover colleagues, they still use the squeeze laser built in my group, but I'm not a co-author here because they deal with it like a commercial product. When you buy a laser, you don't acknowledge and you don't put the company into the author list. And they chose not to do this. So that tells me, okay, it's like any laser, it's really useful and they like it. And the squeeze laser we built in 2010 is still in operation. Einstein telescope, this is my last slide. It will be an underground detector. It will be so sensitive that we will have gravitational wave signals all the time, partially overlapping. And it will be about 10 kilometer long. It will be underground to reduce seismic disturbances. Squeezed light will be a key technology. And yeah, maybe this statement here, merger ring downs will be resolved and possibly, yeah, and possibly even the gravitational wave background from the Big Bang as an underground noise floor below the individual signals will be visible. Coming to my summary. So I have shown you that squeezed light or squeezing the quantum uncertainty of the optical field improves laser interferometers without the need for higher powers, which is crucial in gravitational wave detectors. Squeezing and also entanglement is a cheap technology. Of course, you could try to do material research to get even better mirrors that have even lower absorption, but that will cost you tens of millions, maybe even more. And it's at in 2015, it was the cheapest technology. Oh, we will use 3 or maybe 6 dB of squeezing. And this costs us maybe only 100,000 euros. Yeah, my group started in 2002 with squeezed light, and we realized the squeezing over the full signal. We realized the 10 dB first. Now our record is 15 dB, which is right. It's still the strongest squeezing ever observed. We're now working at the 2 micron because maybe future gravitational wave detectors will work at 2 micron for thermal noise reasons. I will not further go into detail here about this. And we also invented a control scheme, how to stabilize the squeeze ellipse, even if you do not use DC carrier light from the same laser. Well, this basically you're using a shifted local oscillator that is shifted by 40 megahertz, so that the laser relaxation oscillation is far outside the observation band. And yeah, this is success in GEO 600 led to a revised design of LIGO and Virgo. And this is maybe a take-home message. Whenever you now see an announcement of a detected gravitational wave by LIGO and Virgo, it is measured with squeezed light. And this is a kind of old picture from my group in 2014. I chose that one because here you see actually people that contributed a lot to the squeeze laser. And here, for example, you see Henning Fahlbruch and Sascha Kaladowski and Moritz Mehmet. And basically, I would say half of the people contributed to this technology. I thank them, and I also thank you for your attention.
So it's up for questions. But maybe, you know, the speakers are not allowed to ask questions before 5 students ask questions. That was, I don't know, how, did you have the same role in, I think, but we usually had that in schools. So.
Thanks, very impressive. So I have a question on the concept of how you use your squeezed laser. You said the straightforward way would be to just increase the power of your main laser, yep. But you cannot do that because of the power load on the mirrors. So now you're using both of them simultaneously. Is it that you practically replace the main laser, the power of the main laser, with the squeezed laser with advantageous statistics? Why do you use both lasers now? Why don't you just use the squeezed laser?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure whether I got your question, but let me try. When you double the light power of the bright laser, you have twice the number of photons per second. And the quantum noise only increases by square root 2, right? And the signal is directly proportional to the number of photons because the gravitational wave, for example, scatters 10 to the minus 22 of the photons in the DC carrier into the sidebands. So the signal, the gravitational wave signal, is proportional to the power, but the uncertainty is only with the square root of the power. So what you do, you increase the power more and more. And let me tell you this, The only reason to use high power in gravitational wave detectors is exactly this. There's no other reason. Only to reduce the relative shot noise. And squeezing does it differently. Squeezing does not increase the signal, but reduces the noise. So instead of square root n, you have square root n divided by 10. And that improves the signal to noise ratio. Although the signal has the same strength because the signal is proportional to the bright power. Was that your question?
Maybe. So you can use the high power of the main laser and the sensitivity of the squeezed laser all at once.
Yes, okay, this is the best you can do. And this is what we showed together with Rafael, this publication I mentioned. The best concept is to use very high light powers to create the signal. And on top, you squeeze the quantum noise. That is much better and also feasible. And noon states are not feasible.
I have two naive questions. So the first one is, do you need to lock? Maybe I don't know if I'm if this is right. So do you need to lock the main laser and the squeezed laser to each other?
Yes.
And the second one is, I'm trying to understand what, like, how does the squeezed laser, like in terms of the line width, like how does it look like? Like, or maybe it's just something that I don't know. So
yeah, of course, in a gravitation wave observatory, we start from the joint main laser. So if you have a 200 watt laser, we take maybe 100 milliwatts of that, make the frequency doubling, and then shine the doubled light into our squeeze resonator. So it,
that,
everything
that
is phase locked. It's a reference, the same frequency. It's already frequency locked. And then, of course, you have the phase drift because everything expands, and you need to control this. So you have two different optical paths, and you need actuators to make a stable phase difference, which is then on squeezing and not on anti-squeezing.
And then in terms of the line width, or maybe it's just something that I don't understand, like how does it, like how can I imagine it? Like it's not Lorentzian anymore, it's still monochromatic, is that right? Or
the bright laser at 1064 is quasi monochromatic, coherence time 1 second.
That's and like a hertz or
so. It's, I mean, of course you can have line widths that are even more narrow, but here we don't need this. So well, it is an issue. So we, in future, we would like to make the line width even more narrow. But when it comes to squeezing, it is not that important because it's common mode. If the frequency of the main laser changes a bit, the frequency doubler changes and the down-converted field also changes. Yeah. Done. Okay. But there are other reasons to get more narrow line widths.
Are there more questions?
So first of all, thank you for the very nice talk. Very impressive results applied to gravitational waves observatories. Now I was just wondering, obviously there are other fields that would really like to get their hands on like squeezed light lasers. So I was like thinking, are there other areas that you're looking into? For example, like if I remember correctly, shortly before your group started, there was like this wave of continuous variable quantum computing approaches, and they concluded, okay, we need squeezed light, but at the point it's not simply not good enough. So maybe with these impressive results, I think you, or I hope you might comment on if there's some movement in that direction.
There is. So after many years of careful thinking, a team in my group and myself, we are planning to found a company next year to sell squeezed lasers. And first of all, maybe not in the audio band, but at megahertz frequencies. And our goal is maybe up to 10 dB. And yeah, we would be happy if in other fields it will be used. There are plenty of applications. There are many experiments, proof of principle experiments. You can calibrate photosensors without any standard lamp. So the PTB is interested in. You can improve sensing of sensitive biomolecules. Biomolecules, if you shine too much light on them, they are cracked and they are destroyed. So you would like to have the same sensitivity with a lower power. Perfect. Yeah, this is exactly where you need a squeeze laser for. Yeah, and this is in preparation. So I think it next year, 2022.
All right, thanks.
Good.
So if I understood properly, so the idea basically just to superimpose this coherent state with a Pradyumna squeezed state at the end of the day. So, I mean, if one would like a higher value of squeezing, you just squeeze harder the Pradyumna state. But then the problem is that you would get lasing, right? You would get photons in the parametric amplifier on the squeezer. Like, and how bad are them? Like,
I'm not quite sure whether I got your question. It was, yeah, due to the audio conditions, it was very difficult. So maybe because I heard this argument before, we do shine in light from the signal port, and this light is a squeezed vacuum state, and there are photons. And now you could think, okay, if we add any kind of photons to our sensitive measurement apparatus, it can only do bad things. And this is a clear picture you have when you think in terms of photons. Because we knew before, when we have scattered photons, so really photons that scatter into the output, just one can disturb a lot. And now we said, okay, but now we inject, let's say, I don't know, 10,000 photons per second. Yeah. And the people got worried and confused. How can that work? Yeah. But the thing is, you need to think in the wave picture. You have a coherent field that is superimposed by a squeezed field. And then I had this picture here. You simply remove the original vacuum noise and replace it by a squeezed noise. And then only after you have done this superposition, you do the photon measurement, the counting. And then, yeah, the theory tells you the photon counting statistic is squeezed. This is a difficulty of making this jump from wave picture to photon picture. It's clearly written in the equations, but to get the physical understanding is not so easy.
So, thank you so much. It's fantastic results and fantastic works. I have a couple of questions. One is, so you're using this, let me use the word traditional technique for squeezing using the parametric down conversion type of thing. But people have looked at other things. I guess they haven't been so successful. For instance, self-rotation in resonant vapors. So what my first question, I guess, are there any technologies that you see that will be good in the future for this?
Mm-hmm. No. Of course, it is interesting to investigate alternatives because you might then be closer to other quantum systems. So if you produce squeezing with atoms, then you're close to the atom and you can think of hybrid systems. But if you are just want, if you just want to have a highly squeezed state, there is no other way than using a birefringent crystal as it was demonstrated first by Jeff Kimball and co-workers. Because it's so ideal. You only have one macroscopic piece of a crystal, and you do not need to care about thermal Doppler width. It's all negligible. A measurement result. The strongest squeezing we have measured is 15 dB. And we increased the pump power, and we saw 3 dB, 6, 11, 15. And we measured the anti-squeezing in the spectrum. And then we used a very, very simple theory, just squeezing operation plus optical loss. And you can hardly see any difference between the data points and the theory. So it's optical loss. So we only need to reduce optical loss to increase the squeeze factor. But when you go to other systems, they have much more problems. Yeah. So for example, ponderomotive squeezing, where you produce squeezed light that is reflected from an oscillator from a mechanical device. Yeah, the mechanical device has thermal, the Brownian motion. This is a problem that you have only in these systems, but not in a purely optical system. And yeah, it's extremely close to the optimum you can do. So that's why I'm very sure there will be no other technique to produce better squeezing. I mean, the non-linearity we have is basically not important. We can run the system over threshold. Sometimes I read, oh, our system has such a high non-linearity, we could produce even 16 dB of squeezing, which is 1 dB more than ever demonstrated. Yeah, we can produce infinite squeezing. Yeah, we can, because we can go above threshold even. This is not the point. The point is to have a system where you can reduce the loss. We are down to 2.5% loss, total loss, everywhere in the crystal detector, everywhere. And this we want to reduce down to 1%. Then we would see 20 dB of squeezing, factor of 100.
Am I allowed another short question? Thanks. Yeah. What about the space-based gravitational, ELISA, I guess, or whatever it's called? Can you discuss those a bit?
Yes. There are plans, not only plans. There will be the LISA mission, basically European mission, space mission, laser interferometer in space with arm lengths of 2.5 million kilometers. And the length brings you the benefit, yeah, because of the length you can measure a strain, of course, much more sensitive. And the important thing is that you are free from any disturbances that you have on ground on Earth, no seismics. So LISA is targeting the millihertz regime, and it will be sensitive, and it will launch in the 2030s, yeah. And Hannover is a big player there, and but squeezing is not useful because when you shine a light beam over 2.5 million kilometers, you have divergence, and the light beam has a diameter of about 20 kilometers. And you have a photodiode, you don't have a huge mirror of 20 kilometers diameter, obviously. So you only measure, I don't know, let's say 0.1% of the light. That means your quantum correlations are completely gone, and squeezing cannot help. There are other ideas of smaller space-based gravitational wave detectors with arm lengths of 1,000 kilometer with cavities in the arms, and then it would work. Then it would in fact be really good, because such space missions often have the problem that they cannot create so much power because of the solar panels. Yeah, so the power consumption is a limiting factor. And here I have shown you that with a lower power consumption, we can get higher sensitivity. So this is really also a good example of application then.
So I have a crazy question. So you basically have a quantum state of light which is propagating over hundreds of kilometers because you have this cavity and you're making back and forth movement. And as you say, you might have even entanglement between the two arms, and you have gravitational oscillation or fluctuation from. So is there any chance that with that system, you can actually explore some coupling between quantum and gravity or decoherence effect on the. So how far are you from that, or have you thought about it?
Gravity induced collapse of the wave function, like the idea of Roger Penrose. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't think so. Because the gravitational wave detector is not optimized to investigate such questions. But here I would like to refer to my colleague Yanbai Chen, who found out that if you use some other models for quantum gravity, so this is basically the question behind, can we learn something about quantum gravity? And Yanbai found out in the gravitational wave detector, what we could do is we could compare the motion of the mechanical oscillator in phase space and compare it to the rotation of the squeezing, and the two rotation frequency would be different if a Newtonian quantum gravity would apply, which we do not believe, right? But yeah, so you could exclude some simple alternative models. Apart from this, there is some important thing. You need to distinguish between quantum uncertainties that are Gaussian and quantum uncertainties that are non-Gaussian. So, for example, have two strong maxima separated over a macroscopic distance in phase space. This would be a Schrödinger cat state. And then you say, okay, now I have a collapse and the mirror is either here or it is there. And then you can, from this, you could create a reasonable sensitive experiment to test gravity-induced collapse of wave function. But here we have a Gaussian uncertainty. So the mirror is always in this, somewhere in the center. And this is makes rather insensitive to test these Penrose ideas. But in the, but there is some connection.
Olga has a question.
Yeah, so maybe is there some more questions? Because otherwise we'll ask something about your quantum weirdness.
Yeah, right.
So you have, you send in 200 watts of laser light, and there's this very high buildup cavities, and you have megawatts of laser light inside the cavity.
Point eight megawatts.
How much photons do you send in with the squeezed light?
That is a very interesting and good question. So you can calculate the number of photons per frequency band and time, and that gives you a number. So whenever you look up textbooks, they say, oh, 3 dB of squeezing, when you have a mode that is in a squeeze state of 3 dB, in a squeeze vacuum state, then you have more than zero photons because it's not the ground state anymore. You have, on average, 0.2 photons. What does it mean? It means the unit, the physical unit is per bandwidth and second, which cancels out.
Yeah.
So if we are looking for a bandwidth of, let's say, 10 kilohertz, for gravitational wave detector, and maybe the cavities are even more narrow, let's say only 1 kilohertz, we need to consider a frequency band of 1 kilohertz. And per second, if you would like to calculate power, so that this 1 kilohertz gives you a factor of 1,000 that you need to multiply the textbook numbers per second. So it's very low. Yeah, if you have a 3 dB squeeze state and you say it's point something photons times 1,000 is 200. So we are talking about 200 photons that we inject over the band of 1 kilohertz. Yeah.
And that makes an effect that changes the quantum noise of something that is 1 megawatt.
Exactly. And 1 megawatt crazy, right? And 1 megawatt corresponds to 10 to the.
Yeah. It's not crazy. For us, it's not crazy. Yes, I know. If you think about Boris, but if you just look at it, the numbers, it's in the beginning.
You save energy. Because 0.8 megawatt corresponds to about 10 to the 24 photons per second if you have then a beam, propagating beam. Yeah.
Some more questions? There was a question from outside or not? Was there any?
I think you had the last question.
Okay,
as the chairman.
Good. So let's thank Roman and.
Thank you.
Wait. Just a moment, Fritz. Okay. anyway, so thank you very much for accepting our invitation to come to Vienna and giving this amazing lecture. And I hope everyone learned something about squeezed light, how to use it, and maybe it motivates us to learn more about it from here. So this is a small present from VCQ. It's an Imperial Torte, very unique to Vienna from Hotel Imperial. I hope you will like it. So now we'll be meet outside for reception. There is wine, there are sandwiches, so enjoy. And wear masks in the hallway.